Particle shaders are a bit of a dark art. Come close and acquire the powerful forbidden knowledge to let particles do anything you want. You could attract particles to a certain point or number of points, or reflect them from a surface. You could spawn them in crazy ways and distributions, or move them adaptive to user input. You could make them fly in spirals, zigzag, or whatever you think of. And these are just a few examples. We have made one that samples the pixels of a sprite and explodes it pixel perfectly, and one to build a sprite in a similar way. You can click to watch the tutorials if you want. Particle shaders are worth the effort. You can imagine a particle shader as a vertex shader with memory and some extra built-ins. To make one, we have two options. We can build a particle system and convert it, or we can start from scratch. Each of these options has advantages, and we will cover both.
We will first build our shader from scratch. This approach is well suited for particles that should behave very differently from our usual particle system. The only thing that we need to do is give it some texture and add a shader material as the process material. And of course, add a shader. The vertex function will be executed for every particle in every frame. Maybe the most important built-in is the velocity. We can set it and the system will automatically move the particle by that amount per second. If you don't want it, you can disable it with render mode disable velocity. Well done! We successfully programmed a working particle shader. For an attractor-like effect, you would change the velocity depending on the distance to the attractor. Another very important built-in is the transform matrix. It holds the position in the last vector and the rotation and scale of the particle in the first three vectors. We can, for instance, flip the texture horizontally with this line. Of course, we can only see that when our texture is asymmetrical. The particles will time out on their own, but we can also decide to deactivate them by setting the built-in active flag to false. For example, if the particle would leave a certain area. We also have a built-in restart to do something only the first frame the particle exists. Let's add a little gravity. Randomness is very helpful in particle systems, but the way to do it is a bit tricky. We have the built-in number for a unique particle number, or we can use the built-in random seed. But we need more random values than that, and we don't really have a nice random function as we would have on a CPU. So we see a pseudo-random generator function. We will see later that this is exactly what the engine does internally. We can seed it and draw random numbers to randomize the direction and speed. Of course, you can always pass a noise texture as a uniform and sample from that. You can do great things with that, but that is a story for a later tutorial. You can also change the color built-in if you want. For a fade-out, you can decrease the alpha value by delta, which is the built-in for the time between frames.
We should now be able to take a look at a shader converted from a particles material. As you can see, it still behaves exactly as before. The whole behavior is written here. We can look at some of the techniques used. For example, variations of parameters over the lifetime are passed as curve textures to the shader. Curve textures can really come in handy for custom features that should change over time. Imagine speed over time, direction over time, or something like that. Let's see what other features we can discover. Here, a custom lifetime is calculated from the lifetime randomness for each particle. There is a built-in for the maximum lifetime, but we cannot write that one. So in order to keep track of the time the particle exists, we need to write that somewhere. For situations like this, the custom built-in exists. It offers us a vector for to store whatever particle-specific data we want. The remaining custom values are used for the current lifetime, the particle's angle, and its animation offset. So let's say we want the particles to move rhythmically. We can hack this in there by calculating the speed based on our position in the lifetime, a curve we add, and the starting velocity. If you want this to work with features like the particle acceleration, we would need to put more effort into this. But let's say we don't need these features. This can now be tweaked easily. The great thing about converting a shader is that you do not have to write all these lines. However, it can be confusing at the start, and there are likely features in there that you don't really need for this specific particle system. Of course, you can remove them to make the shader run faster. Whenever you want the basic behavior of a particle system with some extra feature, I would advise you to build it in the editor, convert it, and tweak it. Alternatively, you can create your own templates as starting points.
There are so many more things you can do with particle shaders. If you want, you can check out the particle shaders we already have on this channel and subscribe for the ones we will do in the future. We also make devlogs, so maybe check them out as well.